our surgical presentation for this month. And our speaker is Dr. Nirmal Veeramachaneni. He is the Clinical Associate Professor of Surgery and General Thoracic Surgeon and Medical Director of Thoracic Surgery at University of Kansas Medical Center. He received his Doctor of Medicine from University of Colorado and his residency in general surgery and cardiothoracic surgery at Barnes Hospital in St. Louis. He did a research fellowship and NIH oncology training grant at Washington University, and he's board certified in the American Board of Surgery, American Board of Thoracic Surgery, and he is going to give us a talk on minimally invasive surgery. What will we expect in 2017? Let's welcome.
Thank you very much. I greatly appreciate the opportunity. I know we have nurses, students, as well as physicians in the audience. So can I just get a quick show of hands? I see a nursing student contingent. Is that right? Yes? All right. Any residents in the audience? Yeah. All right. Welcome. How many primary care physicians and internists? None? None so far? All right. And this is meant to be more of a surgical talk, but I figured that the audience today would have multiple different needs. So what I tried to do is break up the talk into two different phases. In the first phase, I just wanted to provide a 101 of how we manage lung cancer. And this is geared more towards a primary care practice. So if you saw a patient with what looks like a suspicious lesion on a CT scan, what can you expect to happen to your patient over the ensuing few weeks? So I just wanted to cover some of the framework of how we manage lung cancer and provide an overall gestalt. Then I'll get into a little bit of the surgical changes that have happened over the last several decades and have really changed in the last several years. As part of it, I wanted to go over a brief discussion of chemotherapy, radiotherapy, as well as surgery. This is obviously a very controversial field, I can't do justice to this in 30 minutes to 45 minutes, but at least I want to give you some of the grounding principles. Then I'll also talk about the procedure and then what I call the non-art in the United States and where we have room to grow. So if we look at lung cancer, these are just basic statistics. Although prostate cancer tends to be the number one cause of cancer in men and breast cancer in women, when you look at leading causes of morbidity and mortality, lung cancer is number one in both men and women. And if you look at statistics over the last several decades and what we expect to see as the baby boomer generation starts to age, is that the prevalence of lung cancer, especially in women, will no doubt rise with increased prevalence of smoking that we've seen, especially in women over the last several decades. And unfortunately, despite best attempts, most lung cancer that we see tends to be in the latter column of more distant disease, where the five-year survival, which is in dark blue, is perhaps the lowest. So when you look at the incidence of lung cancer, these are from the NCI cancer statistics, most patients with lung cancer do not present where it's localized to the lung. In most patients, over half of patients, when they present, it's already on the contralateral side or it's spread outside of the lung to some other organ. And about a third of patients present with a disease that has spread to either the lung or the center of the chest, the mediastinum. Very few of what we find is actually localized disease. Localized disease has the best five-year survival. Unfortunately, this is fewest in number. Does Freeman participate in a lung cancer screening program?
Yes.
Okay. So lung cancer screening has been tried for at least three decades, and it wasn't up until about 5 years ago where we actually had one trial that finally showed a benefit of doing CT scans on asymptomatic patients to see if they might have lung cancer. There are very strict criteria for it. On who's eligible and who will pay for it, and there are a lot of stipulations on how to set up the program. The basic problem is the National Lung Cancer Screening Trial, which tried to increase this early detection and early cancer. It was done in academic centers. It had about 10,000 patients. They were randomized either to a chest x-ray or to a CT scan. So the ultimate conclusion of the trial is there's a 20% reduction in mortality with lung cancer screening. You think 20% is a great number, but the devil's in the details. Unfortunately, a 20% relative risk reduction translates to 62 patients over 10,000 patients screened. And unfortunately, unlike other screening strategies, especially if you live in the Midwest, you're going to have a lot of false positives with CT scanning, and you find that you may actually cause more morbidity by actually doing the screening and the subsequent follow-up tests than the actual detection of cancer. Our own experience at KU, I've taken over the direction of lung cancer screening in the last year. We've screened about 200 patients. So far, we've only detected 2 cases of lung cancer, both non-surgically manageable. They were both advanced stage. We found a number of patients who need referrals to cardiologists or urologists because of renal masses that we find incidentally. But the actual detection of lung cancer is small, and that's what one would expect. So if we took a random person walking down downtown Joplin over the age of 65, especially living in the Midwest, you're going to find a lot of granulomatous disease. You'll probably find an abnormal mass in 20 to 30%. Of those, unless they're heavy smokers, less than 1 to 2% are actually going to become lung cancer. Obviously, there are a lot of challenges, and this is an emerging topic. And I just mention it, and I don't have a lot of data slides on it, because over the next few years, I think we'll see more and more publications on how fruitful early detection is going to be. So going forward, so kind of hinted at lung cancer screening, but what happens when you find patients like that or that? This is an example of localized disease. When we scan, when we start evaluating patients with potentially suspicious lesions, the paradigm is always, what is the stage? Is it in the lung? Is it in the lung plus the lymph nodes? Are the lymph nodes in the center of the chest, and has this spread elsewhere? Staging determines how we treat this. So lymph node mapping, especially whether there is disease in the center of the chest, the N2 nodes, or whether nodal spread is only limited to the lung, is of paramount importance. So let me give you a few examples. So this is an example of a CT scan. There's just a very small lesion in the right lower lobe. It barely lights up on a PET scan. You don't see much anywhere else. If you looked at just the scan alone, it is impossible to tell if this patient has lung cancer or not. We live in the middle of the histoplasmosis belt. It's very common to have granulomatous disease. And a PET scan, which I remind patients, it's not a test for cancer. It is a test for what takes up radioactive sugar. So anything that's inflamed will light up. You can have arthritic joints which light up. You can also have certain types of lung cancers which are very slow growing. So if it's not terribly metabolically active, it will not light up. So there's a lot of clinical judgment that goes in terms of advising a patient on what is the probability of cancer. It's smoking history, age, characteristics of the lesion, how FDG avid it is. Obviously there's it becomes a very nuanced discussion on which of these patients you would just follow up with a repeat CT scan in 3 months versus taking them for an operation or attempting a biopsy. Here's an example of more advanced stage. This is a larger tumor, and here you start seeing uptake in the mediastinum. This is a case of N2 disease. To give you the broad framework, if disease is found to have spread, let's start with the most advanced stage disease. These are stage 4. In these patients, they get chemotherapy alone in most instances, or they may get chemotherapy and radiation. The radiation is tacked on more for palliative strategies in the stage 4 setting. For example, you have a tumor that is in the brain. That's a prime target for doing some sort of radiosurgical ablation. In order to deal with it, or if you have a bony metastasis that you want to keep from getting worse and causing a fracture. Where we see primary treatment of with just chemotherapy and radiation alone tends to be in the stage 3A patient. These are where the cancer has spread outside of the lung and it has spread to the central lymph nodes. This is a controversial area, and there are some centers which, for all of these patients, they actually recommend chemotherapy up front followed by an operation. If you go to China, those patients, everyone gets an operation. They may or may not get chemotherapy and radiation afterwards. There are different ways of treating this, but the standard of care in the United States, if we look at NCCN guidelines, is a multidisciplinary discussion, number one, followed in most part by chemotherapy and radiation alone. Very few of these patients actually go on to surgery. And it tends to be a case-by-case instance of limited disease, and these are highly selected patients. What we know from studies where surgery was offered more routinely is that overall mortality was no different when patients got surgery versus chemotherapy, radiation, and an operation. And in fact, if you choose the wrong operation, you probably have done more harm than good. The one large randomized center study that was published in New England Journal actually demonstrated an increase in mortality, especially if a pneumonectomy was done after chemotherapy and radiation. Most of my talk is, however, going to be centered in this group. This is the one-third of patients that we see that are potentially operable. These are early-stage lung cancers, and in general, these patients get an operation followed by some form of cisplatin-based chemotherapy afterwards, assuming that the tumor was greater than 4 centimeters or in size, or if there was any lymph node involvement. Again, a PET scan is it won't necessarily predict the patients who end up needing chemotherapy. So even with a negative PET scan that only shows the tumor lighting up, okay, I'm going to flip back a couple slides. So if we take this patient, for instance, this is the only thing that lights up. The chance of this patient having some form of nodal involvement in the lobe that's taken out is probably on the order of 5 to 8%. So it's small, but it's a real number. When we talk about the operations that we choose for these patients in these early stage, we have a number of options. And so the terms that come up are pneumonectomy, which means removal of an entire lung, lobectomy, which means removing of a lobe. So the lung basically has 5 lobes, 3 on the right, 2 on the left. And each lobe is made up of segments, sort of like, I use the analogy of a tree. So you have branches and you have twigs. If you're just removing a twig, you're removing a segment. In the lung, depending on which anatomy book you read, you have either 18 or 19 segments. And I need to warn people, as you look at the literature and counsel patients, a wedge resection is non-anatomic and should not be confused with a segmentectomy. So words become very meaningful in these discussions. So an anatomic segmentectomy can be as challenging as a lobectomy because you are dividing the artery, the vein, and the airway that goes to a specific part of a lung. When you're doing a wedge resection, you're just trimming it. That's like trimming a tree branch versus taking a twig out. One is technically more complicated, and a segmentectomy is probably a much better oncologic operation for earlier stage tumors. I'm not going to get into the controversy of segmentectomy versus lobe, but I'm going to instead focus on anatomic resection versus wedge. So what's the standard of care in 2017? Again, there are areas that have controversy in this, and we'll touch on those. But since 1995, for early stage lung cancers, a lobectomy over a limited resection, which means generally a wedge resection in the study, has become the standard of care. And this is the reason why. This is a landmark trial. This forms the basis of all of our current recommendations. So in this trial, the recurrence-free survival was significantly better with a lobectomy versus a non-anatomic resection. And if one looks at overall survival, it's 73% versus 56% lobectomy versus a limited resection. Okay. In terms of the patients that we recommended chemotherapy to, I had alluded to the fact that if you find that you've done a complete resection, you have lymph nodes that are positive or tumors that are greater than 4 centimeters, our standard of care is to send the patients off for adjuvant chemotherapy. How beneficial is that? That's really the important question. So the current standard of care in the United States is some form of cisplatin-based chemotherapy. There's three decades of evidence leading to that conclusion. You'll have to take my word on it. I have a separate hour-long talk on how we got to that. But the bottom line is, this is from the LACE meta-analysis. This came in the early 2000s. They looked at thousands of patients who have gotten cisplatin-based chemotherapy, and they looked at, if you are stage 1A and you meet a criteria for chemotherapy, what's the actual benefit? The absolute benefit is 5.3%. That means you're treating up to 20 patients to see the benefit in one. So the way I counsel patients is there is a real value to adding conventional chemotherapy after a proper surgical resection. And you won't know until you try, because unfortunately we still lack the tools to be able to prognosticate who this 5% that's getting the benefit is going to be. And we have different regimens based on age and comorbidities have gotten better since this meta-analysis came out. But this is the standard of care. I'm sure if you even open up the newspaper or watch one of the Super Bowl ads, you see advertisements for chemotherapy. Some of the newer agents are actually immunomodulators. You're trying to affect the immune system to see if we can target lung cancer or other malignancies better. We also look at molecular analysis to see if some of these tumors have specific pathways that are being activated that we can target. Some of the things that we look at are EGFR mutations, ALK mutations, or candidates for immunotherapy. Unfortunately, all of the data for some of these drugs comes from patients who already have widespread metastatic disease, and these drugs are only effective in a small percentage of patients. If you take a look at all lung cancers, only 3 to 5% will actually have an EGFR mutation. And another 3 to 5% will have an ALK mutation that makes them a candidate for crizotinib or erlotinib or one of the newer drugs that become available. So in an effort to kind of to gain an understanding of how we can best treat these patients, the Alliance and the NCI have opened up the Alchemist study. This is an editorial for the surgeons. When you get your American Board of Surgery bulletin, the newsletter that's going to come out, you'll see this figure in next month's bulletin. But the Alchemist trial takes a look at patients who are candidates for chemotherapy after lung cancer resection. These are patients with greater than 4 centimeter tumors or who have any lymph nodes positive. Basically, these patients undergo surgical resection followed by testing of the tumor. They get conventional adjuvant therapy, and then they are randomized to maintenance chemotherapy. Some of these drugs are in pill form, so it's very easy to administer, and the goal is to have at least 450 patients who are EGFR positive randomized to either erlotinib or placebo. So we're taking a fourth line drug and using it more of a adjuvant chemotherapy / chemo preventative trial. It's going to be a very important trial. This was going to take several years to accrue. It's been ongoing for a year, and these show the number of people. So we want to get 8,000, a little over 8,000 patients accrued. So far, there are 200 centers participating, and we have 1,500 patients enrolled. This is as of last month. And if you look, by the time you get down to how many patients actually have the mutation, so far we've only been able to get 86 patients with an EGFR mutation randomized to erlotinib or placebo. This trial is going to take a lot of support over the next few years to get this done. But all is not bad. I mean, this we still have opportunities to improve on what we do. One of the other controversial areas is, instead of surgery, what about radiosurgery? So any radiation oncologists in the room? Okay, I promise this is a fair discussion of this. So radiation oncology, the techniques have gotten significantly better over the last several decades. So morbidity, mortality is clearly better after radiation. They have newer technology to permit higher doses of radiation in shorter intervals with less toxicity to patients. So there's clearly a value to this. But what happens when you try and take a peripheral small little tumor that's early stage And instead of offering the patient an operation, we talk about just zapping it with radiation over the course of a week. Inherently, it seems like a good idea. We know that the local response rate of where a radiation oncologist can treat can be exceptionally high, well over 95% in some reported studies. But how do these patients do? There's obviously a lot of patient selection and bias in the literature. And to date, there's been no randomized head-to-head trial. There are a few coming up, and I'm going to allude to one of these. But if you look at this comes from the SEER database. If you compare patients with lobectomy versus a sublobar resection, and in this case these are all wedges, versus stereotactic radiation, some of the lessons that we've learned from the prior two decades show up again. So if you look at overall survival, patients who get lobectomy do better than sublobar. Now, is this because of patient selection? Did the patient get sublobar resection because they were more frail, had limited lung function, that's why they couldn't get the lobe? We can't tell from these database studies. But if you look at cancer-specific survival, so these are patients who have survived whatever intervention, and you look at lung cancer-specific survival, lobectomy tends to win over time. And if you compare these lobectomy versus SABR, which is stereotactic body radiation, what you see when you look at survival curves, these are comparing lobectomy versus stereotactic radiation, you see how the survival curves crisscross. That usually means that you might have had excess morbidity and mortality in the lobectomy arm. So those patients have died. That's why they initially have a worse survival. Then over time, if they manage to survive their operation, they tend to do better than if they got radiation. So this becomes a question of patient selection. How sick is your patient? What kind of operation are you doing, and can you do it with less morbidity? And what is the long-term oncologic outcome? So I think in the next 10 years, what you will see, much like you see in the head and neck world with head and neck cancer, you're going to find some patients that are probably going to be better off with radiotherapy alone, because their expected survival is low, or we have a better understanding of the nature of their lung cancer. So it might not be the more aggressive kind that spreads early to lymph nodes, even though it's small. So those are the patients that we might send off for radiotherapy. And if you look even more closely at the radiation oncology literature, this came from an ASTRO abstract. There are a lot of abbreviations, but this is lobectomy, wedge, versus stereotactic radiation. And this is disease-specific survival, cancer-specific survival versus overall survival. You see that patients who can undergo a lobectomy, they tend to do well at 5 years. The patients who get wedges versus stereotactic radiation, they're not that far off. Again, this study was done at Beaumont in Royal Oaks, Michigan, a really good medical center. And this is a non-randomized trial. So patients getting wedges, they tend to be sicker because you can't do more of an operation. So at least looking at this literature, if you can't get the gold standard, radiotherapy appears to be somewhat equivalent. Again, we've tried in the past to randomize patients. We've failed. Instead, at KU and a few other centers in the country, we've started the StableMates trial. So in these patients, these are high-risk patients where the surgeon and the radiation oncologist have to agree that a lobectomy is probably a bad idea. And these patients are then advised as to a non-anatomic resection versus radiotherapy. Prior trials have had difficulty accruing patients because patients refused to let the computer decide for them which arm that they were going to fall into. So this has an observation arm. If the patient refuses to be randomized, the patient can still participate in the study. The patient gets to decide which treatment they're going to have, and we'll continue to follow them. So this will be a very good trial. We just started accruing this. We have about 20 patients nationwide already accrued. So we're hoping to get this study done over the next couple of years. And I think of the studies comparing these two aspects of lung cancer treatment, this trial is likely to accrue because patients can choose what they want. So to recap the main points before I get into what I consider the more interesting things of, I can show you slides of lung cancer resections. Recapping the main points is staging is important for optimal treatment. I did not get into the controversies of mediastinal staging with endobronchial ultrasound, the role of MRI of the brain, sensitivity and specificity of PET scan, but there's a large volume of literature and we have standards that have been published. Anatomic lung resection and lobectomy remains the standard of care. There's definitely a role of adjuvant chemotherapy, and I think I highlighted the role of the absolute benefit of cisplatin-based therapy. And radiotherapy definitely has a role in advanced stage disease, but its use for primary early stage lung cancer is controversial and I think should be discussed in a multidisciplinary setting. There's certainly a role for it. So when we think about how lung cancer surgery is done, we've come a long way. So this is where I go into part two of my talk. So the idea of thoracoscopy came back to 1910, where Jacobius, he was a Swiss pulmonologist, and what he was doing was he was using a bladder scope and he put it into somebody's chest in order to try and collapse the chest. This was a treatment for tuberculosis. And that was it for minimally invasive surgery for about six decades. And the idea of doing a pneumonectomy didn't come into play till the 1930s. This is Dr. Evart Schramm. He's a surgeon at WashU. He's credited with actually linking cigarette smoking to lung cancer. Ironically, he himself was a heavy smoker and died of lung cancer. And this gentleman by his side is one of the world's first pneumonectomy patients. He was a retired OBGYN who from Pennsylvania who came down to St. Louis to have his operation done. He actually outlived his surgeon. When we were doing surgeries like this, this is what the surgeon was dealing with. You were dealing with thoracotomy incisions. And over the ensuing decades, there's a large body of literature on making these incisions smaller, sparing the muscle, but essentially they're variations of the same thing. You get an incision on your side, some of the muscle may or may not be cut, but you have a rib spreader to spread the ribs apart, and this is how surgery was done for at least 50 to 60 years in the modern era. It wasn't until 1991 where this Italian surgeon described VATS lobectomy, and the idea was he would make multiple small incisions, use a scope, and then take out the lung that way. That wasn't until 1991. So from 1910 to 1991, people were getting incisions. So why bother with doing minimally invasive? Again, large body of literature, and these are the published positive outcomes, length of stay. A lot of this is heavily influenced by pain management, whether you use an epidural, various blocks, how you manage your chest tubes, how you manage your respiratory care. It becomes a real team effort to get the patients breathing well, ambulating early. But when VATS lung resection became popularized, it became clear, if you looked at the STS database, open lobectomies, patients were staying in the hospital anywhere from 7 to 11 days. The length of stay was cut down by half. So obviously, these small incisions do have some benefit. We described a benefit to adjuvant chemotherapy. So patients who were getting VATS lung resection were more likely to tolerate going on to having chemotherapy. And they could get chemotherapy within 2 to 3 weeks instead of waiting 2 to 3 months for them to for their performance status to improve. Who is operable tends to change. You can do a lot more minimally invasively on somebody with poor lung function than with an open incision. Inflammatory markers are better. There's a cost in disposable supplies. And the final conclusion is a thoracoscopic resection is oncologically equivalent. And I'll highlight three recommendations from governing bodies. So we're basing all of our operations based on thoracotomy, where a rib might be removed or shingled. And we are using various modalities for pain control. And the way, and the principles of most thoracoscopic surgery is that you are able to do the same complete anatomic resection. You make a single incision of 3 to 5 centimeters as your access. No retractors, no rib spreading. You're able to do this anatomically, and you take out the appropriate lymph nodes. Over time, surgeons have gotten better with this technique. When we first started doing minimally invasive lung cancer resection, we generally tended to restrict this to early stage lung cancer, small tumors, and we viewed patients with collapse of their lung, more central tumors as relative contraindications. And again, these are all relative contraindications. Just with increasing expertise, things that you no longer, almost nothing is a contraindication. If you can do it, you can probably, if you have the skill set, you can probably do this. To kind of give you an idea, in our own practice, we've gone from about a 50% VATS rate to about a 95% VATS rate over the last 10 years at KU. So very few patients are actually getting open operations. It still happens, about 1 in 20, but some of these contraindications are no longer just that. And in terms of the evidence recommending thoracoscopic or minimally invasive surgery, you have the International Society of Minimally Invasive Cardiothoracic Surgery, the American College of Chest Physicians. Their guidelines go back to 2007 recommending thoracoscopic surgery if you have the local expertise to do it for all early stage lung cancer. And in the revised NCCN guidelines in 2010, that's also the statement. If you look overall, it's what's happening in the United States, however, not everybody is getting minimally invasive operation. This came from the Society of Thoracic Surgery database. Most thoracic surgeons in the US submit their case log and their outcomes to this national registry. And if you look at, over time, more surgeons are participating. That's why you see the graphs getting bigger. But if you focus on the percent in the early days, of thoracoscopic surgery, maybe 1 in 10 was getting a VATS. By the time you get to 2007, it's 29%. And unfortunately, this number really hasn't changed. It's between 30 and 40% at the last look. So a lot of patients are still getting open surgery, even for early stage lung cancer. If you look at thoracoscopic surgery, it tends to be safe. There's definitely a mortality risk to any time you take out somebody's lung. These are large series of patients. It's about 1 to 2%. The SEER database has a slightly higher percentage. And one thing about thoracoscopic surgery, and you can always convert to an open if you're having difficulty. It's debatable as to whether you call a converting minimally invasive to open a complication, but in some of the early data, conversion rates were as high as 20%. This is Memorial Sloan Kettering data from about 10 years ago. And with experience, this number is now closer to about 5%. Some surgeons, instead of using conventional thoracoscopic equipment, like to use the robot. Nothing wrong with this, but the way the robot works, they use either 3 to 4 ports. It's basically doing VATS, except you have rather expensive equipment. And again, the results of a thoracoscopic versus robotic lobectomy are probably equivalent. Again, we have no randomized data comparing the two. And a lot of this tends to be surgeon preference. Now, one thing I do want to introduce is the concept of taking minimally invasive surgery to the next level. This is single incision thoracoscopic surgery. These are three patients. That's their entire incision. That's a 28 French chest tube. That's all they get for a lobectomy or other complex operations. The pioneer of this is a Spanish surgeon who is now on sabbatical and is training surgeons in Shanghai at Shanghai Pulmonary Hospital. This is Diego Rivas. If you go to YouTube and look up TED Talks, he's got a great talk. It's in Spanish with English subtitles on how he modified this technique about 8 years ago. This has taken off in centers in Europe and in Asia. There are very few of us in the United States offering this. I'm probably one of his first adopters in the U.S. There are about two other surgeons that I know of who do this routinely. I got to KU at 2013. That's when we started adopting this. So basically, this is Dr. Gibson. He's one of our fellows. And it's basically a single small incision. And that's how we do a lobectomy. I'll show you a video on it shortly. But to kind of demonstrate the data, and all of the data that I'm presenting has been published at the Western Thoracic Surgery meeting last July and is pending publication. So in the first year, when I got to KU, I was still doing traditional VATS, two or three incision. So compared to those 35 patients to the next 66 where I was doing uniportal. This shows the types of lobectomies that we were doing. So basically right upper, right middle, right lower, left upper, left lower. Basically any lobe is doable. As my experience gained, we even did three pneumonectomies using that same single incision and one bilobectomy. The stage of cancer in the two arms is basically equivalent. This is registry data, so none of these patients are randomized. And as I was learning how to do this, before I got to KU, I was just in this learning phase where I was just doing lower lobes and simple lobes. And then by the time I got a little bit more experienced, by 2015, essentially everything we were doing was through uniportal surgery. So what's the outcome for the patient? So when we looked at the two groups, again, pre-uniportal, I only have 35 patients, so it's a small number. And this is post-learning phase, 65. No difference in length of stay when you look at the statistics, but what you notice is the median length of stay has shifted. So I was already at about 4 days. I dropped it by a day, and this is what a curve looks like. And for a hospital administrator, this is number of days that a patient is occupying a bed on your floor. So statistically, it doesn't look like you've made a huge impact, but the area under the curve is your utilization. So by going to one incision and keeping everything else the same, because we had the same care pathway, we were pulling the tubes at the same time, we had the same pain management, we're able to get the patients out of the hospital about 1 day quicker. In terms of chest tube duration, it wasn't me pulling the chest tube earlier that was impacting the patients leaving the hospital quicker. They were getting pulled at right about the same time. This is number of hours from the time they left the OR. And in terms, then when you look at narcotic use, especially by day two and day three, if they're still in the hospital, patients with a single incision, they just have a lot less pain. I think this has something to do with it. I need stronger data than just a case series like this, but this is an emerging technique. So to put it simply, since the introduction of using a scope to break up adhesions for TB, not much happened until 1990 with the first publication of VATS. And this is when Dr. Rivas described the uniportal technique. It's in the same era that we see the explosion in VATS technology and using the robot. And this little stripe is where I was trained. So I feel very fortunate to be well past the learning curve, so I'm not having to learn this out of fellowship. And if we look at nationwide trends going up to 2012, the dark blue shows the percentage of cases that are being done by traditional VATS. That percentage has plateaued around 30%, and in this teal color you see the rise in robotics. So what's happening is a lot of surgeons who have difficulty adopting thoracoscopic technique, they switch over to the robot. There's a different learning curve, and if one technique doesn't work, they switch over to the other one. So most of the increase that we're seeing is with the rise of robotic lobectomy. And I think this trend will probably increase. Unfortunately, all care in the United States isn't necessarily equal. I think Tip O'Neill said all politics are local, and the same thing applies for medical care. So if I look at just the Kansas City community, I belong to one of four major competing health systems. And the variability in what patients are offered at the four systems differ widely. So if you end up at one of our hospitals, everybody gets a thoracotomy. Their surgeons don't do any VATS at all. They're primarily cardiac surgery focused practice, but if you go there, you're getting a thoracotomy. At another institution, the surgeon does only robot. In our place, we offer both, but I've gone exclusively to VATS and Uniport, and some of the next generation techniques are not even intubating these patients. Dr. Rivas Gonzalez, he actually has excellent videos showing lung cancer resection in non-intubated patients. It's basically propofol and single incision, and it does work. I've done it for select procedures other than lung cancer resections, but it is doable. So we're seeing change in practice patterns. So with that, I would like to stop, and what I actually want to do is entertain any questions. Yes, sir.
Yeah, how much is the literature emphasizing on the lymph node sampling, you know, that you get it in this, like, in your cases, you know, the pathology tells you that how many lymph nodes did you get it, okay?
So pathologic staging, especially for the lymph nodes, is of utmost importance. So the way I approach it is, we take a lot of the pathologist out of the equation. The way I do it is, when I do one of these cases, I will actually send 8 different specimen cups, and I go station by station. Yes. The current standard of care recommended by the ACS is also, even if you open up a station, for example, you open up a station 9 and you don't see anything there, dictate it into your operative note.
So you do sampling or lymph node dissection?
So if it's early stage, we have no proof that a dissection is different from sampling. So the question this gentleman is asking is, how do you handle these lymph nodes? For example, when you sample lymph nodes, you can look for things that look enlarged and just pluck those, or you can do systematic sampling, which is what all of our literature actually uses, at least in North America, where you look at level 4R, you look at level 5, all of these defined anatomic areas. You might not strip out all of the cancer, but you at least take them out and do a frozen section or do something with them. And then there's lymph node dissection, which is a concept of clearing everything out. So we have one randomized prospective trial comparing dissection versus systematic sampling, where the patients had all of these things looked at. At least for early stage lung cancer, shows no difference. So our own practice is I dissect everything out. And for more advanced disease, you should probably do a dissection.
So my second question is that in the literature, when they compare open thoracotomy to VATS, is there any difference of the lymph nodes, you know, numbers of the lymph nodes?
Not anymore.
Not anymore, because I cannot quote the literature right now, but I have seen it. There is a difference for that, you know, and that's why it's a vasectomy is falling out of this, you know, minimally invasive kind of thing, because lymph node numbers are pretty important. That's why robotic people are going more towards the robotic, because the lymph node dissection is much easier than with the VATS. And some people, I mean, there is a literature that the number of lymph nodes is less in VATS as compared to open thoracotomy. Yeah. Is that correct statement?
Yes, that is a correct statement.
So do you think that affects the oncologic results?
No. Well, it's, so basically, I think for early stage, you can try and take out more. But also what ends up happening is there's a learning curve to this. As you get more experience with VATS, I'm watching Diego do some of his videos, and they spend as much time on the nodal dissection after they've taken the lobe out in these early stage tumors as the actual lobe. It's a thorough dissection, but highly skilled hands. So a lot of it's user error or user comfort.
Second question, when you're taking this lung out, you know, do you smash it like with the 3 centimeters like this much?
You put it into a bag.
But it doesn't come. I mean, I have seen them. I'm trained with the bags, you know, then they fight, you know, like wiggling.
So the trick is when I do a uniportal incision, I make it much, the incision is a little bit more anterior, and the cartilage will spread. I haven't broken any ribs yet, and and even with a new meniectomy, that incision obviously has to be bigger than 3 centimeters. And it's mostly at the skin level that you have to make it a little bit bigger, but it's very doable.
Okay.
From a surgeon's perspective, do you think that the U.S. Preventive Task Force got it right with their recommendation for low-dose CT?
That's a challenging question, because I have whole talks on the dangers of lung cancer screening. Some of the controversy is when CMS set out to either say yay or nay to adopting this recommendation, their own advisory task force recommended against offering lung cancer screening. And the main reasons for that were variability of care delivery in the United States. So the lung cancer NSLT was done under highly controlled situations, mostly at academic centers where you had good chest radiologists, you knew the nature of the equipment, and plus you also had the surgical backup. For instance, if you're a small community hospital and you have a surgeon that doesn't even do thoracoscopic surgery routinely, I don't think it's a good idea. I mean, that's one of the main reasons. So if you have all the tools that you need, it might prove effective. Again, we only have one trial after three decades of negative trials. I remain skeptical. We're doing it, but I remain a little skeptical. And also, from an economic standpoint, the way the CMS has mandated it, it's almost like setting up a separate tumor board just for lung cancer screening. You need to maintain a registry. You need to document every other study that comes from your screening. For example, if you get a biopsy or a stress test, you have to document what happened and you have to follow these outcomes. I think CMS wants to get a handle on how much more it's going how much additional testing and such we're going to do, plus the outcomes. So it becomes a regulatory burden, and the reimbursement for it, it doesn't make much sense for many physicians to be involved in it, given the amount of counseling. And it's more than just ordering the test. You have to have a face-to-face conversation with the patient that you can document, highlighting the risks and benefits, have a discussion regarding the long-term radiation risk, and the patient has to be made clear that they're going to have a CT scan annually well into their 70s for this to work. So that's the other pitfall to this. So it's going to generate lots of scans. How much cancer we're going to find, it's going to be small.
Are you doing, when does the mediastinoscopy come into play? Are you doing that immediately prior to this procedure, or is that done concurrently? I mean, how are you doing that?
So the current indications for mediastinal staging before the time of lung cancer is for non-T1N0. So if you have a clinical T1N0, there's no recommendation currently for those patients to get a mediastinoscopy beforehand. The time I do it is if on a PET scan it looks like they're N1 positive, definitely they get some form of mediastinal staging. And in our hands, it's become endobronchial ultrasound. So the number of actual mediastinoscopies I do is really small because the concordance rate from if I have nodal tissue on the EBUS and I can truly call it a true negative. So it comes down to definitions. So if you do an endobronchial ultrasound and you stab a lymph node, and it comes back as blood or respiratory epithelium, that's neither positive or negative. In those situations, you probably do a med. But if you have good tissue, I've gone from routine mediastinoscopy to just endobronchial ultrasound. It's just from experience.
So you're basing the clinical N0 on your radiographic PET scan during your initial evaluation?
Correct. Or anything that's central, for example, if you're trying to upstage a patient for other reasons, if you have a central tumor, it's greater than 4 centimeters, they're all going to get some form of preoperative mediastinal staging.
But you would not do that the same day. I'd be waiting for your path. You're not doing things on frozen sections or anything.
At University of North Carolina, I used to. I had two dedicated lung pathologists who, and we tracked their outcome. They just weren't wrong from their frozen. At KU, I split them into separate days. You have to rely on your local resources. It's not a knock on them. The dedicated lung pathologists are difficult to come by.
Gotcha.
Thank you all.